which attests to that fact. Obviously, those were two great centuries, and Pablo Picasso and many others, if they want to be remembered as greats, they will be compared with those masters. In fact, you're going to see, okay, I'm pretending, I don't know what I'm doing. You're going to see, this is that kind of high-pressure printing press we talk about. Think about this. 5x8 plate, you push through a high-pressure printing line like this, you need to know exactly what you're doing in every single step of that process. Now, as we are wrapping up over here, I must say, art washes away the soul from the soul, the dust of everyday life. I think there's so much merit to that statement. Now, I will actually talk about the last artist over here. Though reluctantly, we're going to give an abbreviated version because I'm talking too much over here. I'm going to talk about Marc Chagall, ladies and gentlemen, one of the greatest artists of 20th century over here. He lived a very long life, almost 100 years of age. His artistic apotheosis was a beautiful melange between brilliance of color and lyrical poetry. The basic gist of it all, he had weightless figures defying the laws of gravity with brilliance and saturation of the color that it was almost chromatic, palpable colors. One of the greatest colors that have ever lived. Now, he was born in Vipitesk, Belarus. He was oldest of nine children, I would say. He was also stillborn, just as Pablo Picasso. His name was actually Moshe Siegel. He was a Hadashi Hebrew. He changed it to Marc Chagall. Now, Pablo Picasso received a big puff from a cigar. What they did with Marc Chagall, they actually plunged him in an ice bath and poked him with needles. Shocking, but it worked. He was alive. Now, Marc Chagall did many very great things during his life. He was a great painter. I want to show you how he actually incorporates different styles, because in early 1900s, he actually escaped Russia. He went to Paris. He was part of the group of people in La Roche-Montpagne. It was a district over there where artists would congregate and extrapolate on the idea and bring it to the fruition by the virtue of the artwork and by the virtue of the writings. Artists such as George Braque, as Pablo Picasso, Apollinaire, the writer, they were all there congregating, Matisse, and actually feed off each other creativity. That is why in 20th century from Paris you have such an immersion of great artists, because they were all there working and they would challenge each other with their creativity. Now I want to show you, he defied classification. It was everything but nothing. They actually call his style Chagallian. Let me point out over here a few things. This is one of his greatest works I've ever created. It's called I Am the Village. You're going to see over here a very surrealistic depiction of the village. Over here, you're going to see this is village of Vipitesk over here. You're going to see a cart in the church upside down, obviously, a bucolic scene of folks, town folks. Over here, obviously, you see the milkmaid in the face of the cow. Over here, you're going to see this is very cubistic rendering over here, distorted shape and form. You're going to see, and also coloration, you're going to see he's influenced by coloristic vocabulary of masters of fauvism, a very non-representative use of colors. He actually amalgamated all those styles and he created his own visual vocabulary. He was everything but nothing. That is the genius behind him. I must also note, he was the greatest poet of 20th century, though he never wrote a poem in his life. He was actually only explaining his artwork, but he was congregating there with those poets, like Apollinaire. So he knew his way with words. I want to show you over here one of the greatest works of art I've ever created. Actually painted this 1915, his golden birthday. Now, I must say, his constant and never-ending source of inspiration was his wife, Bella. He loved it so much. He met her when she was underage. They corresponded from Paris to Russia, and then he actually went to Russia. He married her, and after Bolshevik Revolution, he actually brought her to the Paris. Now, she passed away. Listen to this. She passed away in 1946. He passed away in 1985, so virtually 4 decades, 39 years after her passing, he would still paint her in his artwork. It was not a doubt. He remarried. He found another woman, Vala Brodsky. He lived with her, loved that woman. However, never forgot the love towards his wife, Bella. He actually said, when he explained this work of art, he said, "First I kissed my newly black Bella, I felt I was flowing. The newly found romance impacted every brushstroke in my art for the next 15 years of my wedded bliss. All I needed to do is open the window in the stream blueness of sky, love and flowers with her." Incredibly romantic. You're gonna see those weightless figures over here. He said, "When I kiss my wife Bella, I feel I'm flying." That's what he was known about. Now, I must say, his greatest legacy to us is not the art of painting, it's actually lithography. Marc Chagall was the greatest lithographer that I've ever lived. He said himself, when I'm holding a lithographic stone, I feel I'm holding a talisman on which I can express all my joys, sorrows, and fear upon. The lithography was the greatest thing Marc Chagall had ever done. He actually learned in a Merlot studio under Jacques Soulier for 2 years, just the rudiments of lithography. If you recall, I explained this in a lecture yesterday, just for the sake of emphasis, if you were not there, I'm going to repeat this. Obviously, the litho means stone, graph means drawing. It's a stone drawing technique. Obviously, it's archaic Greek, little translation. The artist needs a Bavarian or Belgian limestone. That is something that needs to be used, and it takes a film of water, places on top. The reason being because it's based on the chemical principle that water and grease, they repel each other. They have immiscible properties. If you recall, I mentioned the analogy, you put oil into water, it's going to flow. Same thing. Well, you cover it with a film of water, then he takes a greasy crayon, two-shot wash, an oily substance, and he draws the design in to the stone. Now, it has to be in reverse, same as etching, but it also has to be colored by a color application. Let me explain. He actually creates this design, then he takes an ink roller, let's say with black. He takes an ink roller with black ink, he rolls the ink on top of the stone. Everywhere where the grease is will attract the ink. Make sense so far? Everything else will be washed away by water. Then he takes a piece of paper, places it on top, pushes it through a high-pressure printing press, and then you have a mirror image impression of what he has created. Now, if you want to add another color, he actually developed this. The first color was introduced by Henri Toulouse-Lautrec. He did four stone lithographs, because you need four stones. You need another stone to add another color. And people are in awe how he was able to do that, because you have to perfectly align them. For example, if you want to add red to this roof, what you need to do, obviously you have all the markings, you would use the same stone, grind the stone obviously, and you would mark this area over here with a greasy crayon, then it would take red, roll the red on top, and that red would be only in this triangle area. Then you take a sheet of paper that has all the markings of black, you place it on top and push it through a high pressure printing press, and then you have another color. Four stones, it was at most that people would use, because they couldn't fathom more than that. Well, Marc Chagall actually developed it to 44 stones. 44 stone lithographs. This is something that he developed, and till this day, no one has surpassed the genius of Marc Chagall lithography. I will say for a fact, 1985, when he has passed away, that day, he actually finished his last lithograph in his life. He finished the last lithograph, went to bed, and he passed away. And that actually was printed in Merlot's studio. That was the most famous studio in Paris. It was printed over there, and they closed their door on the day, obviously, when he passed away. They printed that lithograph, and that's it. That studio no longer prints any marble. But obviously, we know Marc Chagall was all about colors, obviously, and to do it with a stone, it was unprecedented, to say at least. A few things I'm just going to mention about him. He actually was a very adept glass painter over here. He did this in the United Nations in New York. Now, he was a Hadashi Hebrew in France during World War II. Not a very good combination, obviously. He fled. America gave him a helping hand, as they said, we're going to give you asylum. Come to New York. He spent some time there, and obviously he created some great works of art. This is in United Nations in New York. He created glass windows over there, which is quite fantastic. He actually worked with Mint and also created some set stage design on a longer cruise. Actually show you, we don't have time over here. He did a few things over here, obviously glass stained windows. Over here we will see his magnum opus was actually, he created a ceiling in Opera House in Paris. People were outraged. Hadashi Hebrew is gonna paint their ceiling? People were not very happy about that. When he was finished, they called him Michelangelo of our time. Obviously, they were in awe because he created incredibly beautiful artwork over here. Then you have here Knesset Parliament. He did some beautiful tapestry as well. Speaking of stained glass window, I want to show you over here. You're going to see this one in Hadashi Hebrew Medical University in Jerusalem. It has 12 windows ubiquitously. Each of them have their own color. He created it to its fullest. Marc Chagall was all about color. Color is something that he understood with great precision. Now, folks, that is the end of the lecture. Did you learn something? Did you have fun? Did you enjoy yourself? A round of applause over here. I went a little bit overboard. I know this is what happens when you come to my lectures. I know some of you actually left on the on dinner. I must say, just before I let you guys go, I procured some exceptionally fantastic things for this cruise. Now, this is not for everyone. I will actually show them. I'm gonna have a little VIP get together in 2 days' time. Well, I will. It's my way of saying thank you for coming on the events, for collecting and having fun with us. So we're gonna have this about 7:30 over here in 2 days' time. I'm gonna give you a heads up over here.